Now you gotta be ready to go out there and earn it, guys. You have to earn it. You understand? They wanna take what you got, you gotta go get it and go after it. And every guy in here's gotta do it for whatever your role is. Every play in the game for 60 minutes, you got it?
It gives me great pleasure to introduce the next coach of the Crimson Tide, Nick Saban.
I can't tell you how pleased and honored I am to be your coach at the University of Alabama. The spirit and enthusiasm.
5 yards out to win it for the Volunteers. The snap, the spot. It's blocked by Alabama. The Crimson Tide wins.
Consider the scene at Tuscaloosa Regional Airport that began assembling at 8 in the morning on the day of Nick Saban's arrival. A woman led a cheer, or maybe it was a prayer. It went like this. Praise the Lord, God is good, we got Saban.
McElroy under center, busy backfield. Play action fake, rolling right, the throw to Upchurch, touchdown! Touchdown, 4 yards!
And execute the plan, do your job, play your gap, run your route, throw the right guy, get turnovers, be physical on the line of scrimmage, and do it every play in the game.
Back pedals, look, throws, it is intercepted by Javier Arenas in the end zone!
Our guys did a great job of being physical today, and I'm just proud of the fact that we won the SEC championship, and I'm going to just enjoy that for now.
Alabama, the dreaming is over. California, here we come. Offensive line, now a full house backfield. Here's the Gav Ingram touchdown. He gallops behind Terrence Cody for 2 yards. Alabama wins its 13th national championship. And the roses in this grand old stadium are once again crimson.
Period.
Just blood leak.
Blood spirit.
Yeah. In this particular one, this was just basically Sam Mike protection, scat protection.
This is the way everywhere we went in on Bill, this is the way everybody covers stacks. Not like our old way, the way everybody used to.
Because of his defensive mind, is he can actually do a great job of seeing what the other defenses are doing to try to take some of the things away that you're trying to get done offensively. And, you know, at times I actually wish he was more involved because he can give such an insight as to what the other team's trying to do.
You know, Nick is so cerebral as a coach, and he can talk concepts of the game, and he can get easily frustrated with coaches or people that are around him that are not thinking on the same wavelength. And, you know, oftentimes the coaches that have had the most success with Nick have been those that can really talk football without having to go draw it up and have a meeting about it.
There's not anything that he leaves to chance, and I think that's ironically very, very rare in the world of sports. You know, working for IMG, arguably the largest sports management agency in the world, I have a responsibility to deal with many of the best athletes and high performing, you know, power players in the world of sports, and without question, Coach Saban is in a league of his own.
Well, I don't care how it's written up. If the money always goes, we should make the rule that the money always goes in the A-gal. Because the money always goes, so you never change the splits back.
That's always been the issue. It changed when the safety didn't go.
The money had to know where he went.
I know, but we ought to just make it one way. So then the safety's either going outside and giving a hand to drop call or a line call, and it never changes the money. That would clean it up.
When Nick came to the Browns, I mean, he was a very, very good football coach and strong in every area. In the 4 years that we were there together, you know, I learned more from him than I've learned from any other coach. Defensively, his knowledge of techniques, schemes, adjustments, how it all fits together was exceptional.
With all the one back we're getting, Pepper, I'm gonna start giving you auto two so we can go to flex. play two for seven cut.
He has unique ability to make everybody in the building single-minded in purpose. I mean, there's nobody in that building that isn't doing something to try to win. I don't care if it's the guy that's cleaning the locker room at night. I mean, he feels like he has a purpose in what he's doing. And he's extremely, extremely talented in making people buy into that theory. And either it's either talent, fear, or all the things combined that the people buy into, because I'm telling you, when you go to that building, you can see it at Michigan State, you can see it at LSU, you can see it at Alabama. Everybody knows there's you know, you're either gonna win or we're gonna be miserable, one of the two.
Every day, he sets the tempo to the staff. We have a 7:30 staff meeting every day. And he sets it and lets everybody know when he brings to the table, this is what I want done, this is how I want it done. And when the coaches know, all we have to do is execute the plan.
Blow the horn. Come on, hustle up. Let's go, guys. Get your mind right. Let's go.
Oh, he's a very hands-on. I mean, he's on the field. He's going to be involved. You know, he's mainly going to be on the defense side of the ball. But every now and then, I'd be standing there calling a play on offense and just feel somebody over your shoulder, and he'd look back and he'd be standing there watching you. And not to really watch his coaches as much. He wanted to see what was going on. But I think, and as a head coach, he understood the importance and the presence that he has to have on the offensive side of the ball. And being a defensive guy, everyone knew that. But letting the offensive players say that, hey, I'm not just a defensive coach, I'm your coach.
Switch. Jam him, Rod. Now roll and run with him, Rod. Roll and run with him. It's switch. You're carrying, right? All right, now if it's Mott and one short, what do you do? That's right. All right, so you got two. You got me?
He's a good field coach. He's not many head coaches coach. You know, I got to, at the end of my career, I didn't coach. I'd let the other coaches coach. But he still coaches, and he's one of the best teachers that I've seen.
All right, can we do post-corner rollover? That means you run to this line and roll over the corner. Set, go, back pedal. Post, corner. I know you ain't used to this kind of arm strength. Set, go.
If I take one thing from Coach Saban, it's probably that the coaches don't coach enough how to do it. They focus on what to do all the time, and how to do it is a lot more technical. You know, how do you press a guy man to man? How do you play a ball in phase, out of phase? How do you tackle a guy? And so many kids today, they don't know that, and they don't get taught that. They just get told, tackle better, catch the ball, you know, make the tackle.
Set, go, step out. Don't do that. Don't drop your hips. You just step out. Just set, and then step out with this foot. All right, watch me do it. Here I go, set, come on. Go, I set back, come on, and then I'm gonna step at you to block you. Not, you're doing this. And that just opens the gate for the guy.
One of the Mountain State success stories returned to his roots today. Marion County native Nick Saban, head coach of the national champion Alabama Crimson Tide football program, was at the Charleston Marriott. Saban has coached two national championship teams. The most recent was in January.
It's great to be home. It's great to see good friends. And, you know, Joe is one of our best friends in the world. And it's always good to come home because, you know, everybody talks about all the accolades that you get and all the accomplishments that you make. But, you know, all those things are kind of, there's conditional and unconditional love. And when you come back home to West Virginia, it's always unconditional love, and it's great to be here.
When I grew up in Carolina and I stayed with my grandmother a lot and played Little League baseball, there were seven rows of houses, and you knew every person that lived in every house, and they knew you. And I had great family, great parents, but a lot of good role models when I was growing up, and I think that's something that probably had a great effect on me as a young person.
Well, we know him as brother, and anybody from home in West Virginia always knew him as brother. And that name came to him by his sister, Deanie, who basically his father was Nick. So you had Nick Sr. and little Nick. Before you knew it, it was go get your little brother for this. And it just kind of little brother kind of turned into brother.
So people really don't know me by Nick there. And to this day, when people call, whether it's for tickets or to say hello or to talk, they always say his brother there. So everybody in the organization sort of knows that that person's from your hometown.
I tell you, brother never did get into trouble of no kind. And he was always easygoing. And now his dad had that type of influence. His mother did too, both of them. They were good. They were just good kids.
Well, you know, we kind of had a little service station and a little Dairy Queen across the street, and it was a family-run business, so everyone was involved. You know, my mother worked in the Dairy Queen, my sister worked in the Dairy Queen, my dad ran the station, I worked at the station all the time, so it was really kind of, the business was kind of a part of our life.
He's a product of his environment. Hard work ethic. Do it and do it right. If you don't, do it over until it's right. And it's because of his father. And that's exactly who he is. His greatest thrill and the greatest gift he can give a young person is to teach him to be a young man and be responsible. And he got that from his dad.
He was always involved in sports, and he was always a coach of something, whether it was a Sandlot baseball team, a basketball team that played in a league, a rec league, or American Legion baseball. So when we were young, you know, he decided that he wanted to start Pop Warner football in our area. So he did start the Adam A. Black Diamonds, and a league formed sort of around that.
To be a coach of the little Pop Warner team was his passion. It's what he loved, working with these children. And they didn't have much. None of us had much. But he bought the school bus and went into all these little towns and valleys and up in the mountains to pick up the children, to take them to this field and to coach them. And I think it changed their lives.
And in the bus, there were all these sayings about it's nice to be important, but it's more important to be nice. And, you know, you're liable to meet the same people on your way up that you meet on the way down. And, you know, just little things like that, that sayings about being the best you can be, and just things that impacted you a little bit when you're a young person thinking about what does that really mean.
I believe that Nick Saban Sr. is the reason Nick Saban Jr. is the great coach that he is, because he was a good mentor in all aspects of life, not just to brother, but to all kids he came in contact with.
He wanted to see brother be a good athlete. He was good, but he didn't have all the tools either. You know, he didn't have the height. He was small, you know, but he was smart. Now say that for him. He knew the game.
He was all-state in three sports and captain in all three sports of his team, so he's always been a leader.
The coach at that time decided that the quarterback just wasn't doing the job. You know, he had good fast halfbacks, he had good linemen, but the quarterback was a little weak, and so he looked down in the ranks, and there was Nick Saban, a sophomore who he brought to be a quarterback on the varsity football team.
The game always came easy to me, even when I was a high school quarterback. I called the plays when I was 15 years old, and called plays in Pop Warner, and was always the quarterback. So saw the game from a big picture and always knew what everyone was supposed to do on every play.
I would go down to the house a lot of times, and his dad would have him watching 8mm film. And that was when film was unheard of. And I would be standing over, and he'd say, "You want to stay and watch film?" And I said, "No, I do not. I want to go home."
At 15, he was remarkable. Once I gave him the team, I did not have to worry. He made me an awful good coach.
I say this at every clinic that I speak at. Every clinic, I speak to 3,000 or 4,000 to 2,000 people that are all high school coaches every year. And I tell the high school coaches, just so they understand, I say, besides my parents, the person that had the greatest impact on my life was my high school coach. So that you understand, as high school coaches, how important you are to the people that you influence, the people that you engage with, that you communicate with, that you set an example for, the principles and values that you represent in the program that you have. So that's what I have to say about this guy right here, who was, Earl Keener was the person who impacted probably my life at a time when I was most affected, you know, when I was a young kid. Thank you, Coach.
You all, your support, your passion, the tradition that we've had, which has come from your passion and support through the years, has made being the coach at the University of Alabama very special. I know it's what helps our players in terms of their spirit and their passion to be able to accomplish the kind of things this team last year was able to accomplish in terms of winning a national championship, winning the SEC championship, all things that I know you're very proud of. But your support is a very big part of that. And I thank you. And I want to thank you for all of your support. The day that we walked out in this stadium in 2007 and there were 92,000 people there, I knew that we would accomplish something special because of your passion and your interest and your love for your school and the University of Alabama. And that's what makes it special to be here. That's what makes it special to be a coach. And that's why we have been able to accomplish special things in 3 years. And you are a big part of that. And we thank you so much for it. And roll tide. Thank you very much.
Focus on the play.
Concludes. What do you know about your football team that you did not know a month ago?
Well, we made a tremendous amount of improvement, and I think the big thing that you worry about is how the players are going to focus on the process of what they need to do in the future, and how complacent are they going to be about what they've accomplished in the past. And I've been really pleased with the work ethic and the way we've sort of made progress as a team by staying focused on the things we need to do to get better.
Football in SEC country is religion, maybe not metaphorically. Consider the scene at Tuscaloosa Regional Airport that began assembling at 8 in the morning on the day of Nick Saban's arrival. A woman led a cheer, or maybe it was a prayer, went like this. Praise the Lord, God is good, we got Saban. Nick and his wife Terry are headed back to the college life they so desperately missed, where he will once again attempt to walk on water.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce the next coach of the Crimson Tide, Nick Saban.
I can't tell you how pleased and honored I am to be your coach at the University of Alabama.
The spirit and enthusiasm that has been demonstrated to myself and my family has been phenomenal. And I think everybody should take the attitude that we're working to be a champion, that we want to be a champion in everything that we do. Every choice, every decision, everything that we do every day, we want to be a champion.
When we made the decision to make a change that particular year, I recognized, and I think most everyone recognized, it was one of the most crucial hires ever for Alabama.
And I think he wanted somebody who had proven that they could win, and somebody who could win championships and take teams to BCS bowls and compete at that level, because that's why they were making a change. Again, it wasn't that Mike Shula had let everything become a disaster and that Alabama was finishing last in the league. It's just that they were sort of stuck in the middle, and I think Alabama didn't want to be stuck in the middle. They wanted to compete at the highest level, and they wanted a coach who had proven he could do that.
West Virginia football coach Rich Rodriguez will remain just that, head football coach at West Virginia. In a stunning turn of events, Rodriguez, who appeared headed to Tuscaloosa as the new leader of the Crimson Tide, returns to Morgantown. This is the latest in a series of setbacks for the Alabama coaching search, now entering its third week.
Nick Saban had already kind of faded from the spotlight at that point, and I'd never heard a more distraught group of fans. There was absolute depression in the state, and this was 2 weeks before Christmas, and it didn't look like Alabama could find a single person to take this job.
So I had people calling me from Alabama, reaching out to me, and all I could tell them was, look, I can't promise you anything. I don't know that he'll even talk to you. I don't know that he'll meet with you. And Coach Moore was begging me in December, just let me fly to Miami and meet with him for 30 minutes on his off day, and then I'll leave him alone. And I'm like, Coach Moore, it ain't happening. I mean, he's not gonna meet with you.
As the year ended and we were going to a bowl game, I still had not talked with Coach Saban, and that was making it difficult. And I'm trying to hire a coach that I felt in my heart wanted out of the NFL, and I felt because of Alabama's great name and great history, we could attract most any coach.
By this time, all the machine at Alabama was rolling. We got to get Nick Saban. And that's where all the questions were creeping back to Miami at the press conferences. So every time Coach Saban would go in front of a camera, you know, some writer out there from Miami would say, hey, I heard somebody say you might be interested in Alabama. And he would no comment and not talk about it. Finally, he just got sick and tired of it because they kept pounding him and pounding him and pounding him. And when he answered that question, I'm not going to be the coach at Alabama, I don't think for a minute in his mind he thought he was going to be.
In the course of a season, you know, he's got reporters who are asking over and over and over again, and you know, he's probably tired of answering the question. He felt like that was the best way to postpone having to deal with the question.
Yeah, he took a lot of heat for that decision, really unjustly. Those of us that really know what happened, and there's not very many people in the world that do, will stake our integrity on the fact of that. I mean, he never would discuss anything with Alabama, with anybody from Alabama.
The Sunday after that, Coach Saban plays his last game as the head coach of the Miami Dolphins, and they play the Colts in Indianapolis. So Monday, I flew to Miami, to Fort Lauderdale, and checked in a hotel, not knowing if he would talk to me or see me.
Coach Moore is already flown down to Florida on a whim. I mean, just trying to, you know, I remember saying to him, Mal, what are you thinking? You might like be on the street corner and pass him, get to talk to him. I mean, you don't have a meeting with him yet. Why are you going down there? And he goes, because if you can talk him into meeting with me, I want to be, you know, 2 miles away from him so I can go talk to him. It was really a gutsy move on Mal's part, looking back on it. At the time, I thought it was crazy, but the way it turned out, it really was gutsy on his part.
It was like being at the other end of the phone back in junior high, asking somebody out for your first date. I mean, you just knew they were going to say no. And there was that feeling. There was no confidence. Yeah, everyone had heard the rumors. Everyone knew it was going to come to that point. But, you know, one day dragged to the next, and the next day dragged to the next, and there was almost a defeatist attitude that there's no way Nick Saban is going to take this job.
There was always a tremendous respect for the tradition and the program at the University of Alabama. And the commitment at Alabama was right. It was the right time. It was the right place. It was just a real conflict in terms of loyalty to the Miami Dolphins, to Wayne Huizenga, and putting ourselves in a situation that was probably a mistake in terms of who we were and what we wanted to do.
And Coach pretty much said to me what I had said to people 15 years ago. They said, "Now when I go to work, I feel like I'm working at a factory. Never see anybody." He missed the college atmosphere, the college spirit. And I know that Miss Saban loves recruiting, and so did Coach. You know, if you need a quarterback in the NFL, you trade for one or buy one. The wife's not involved necessarily. But here, it's a kind of a family deal, recruiting another family to join this team.
And I think that after talking to Coach Moore, you know, and after talking over with Terry, his wife, and with me, we all sort of came to the conclusion that, you know, college football was where his heart is.
During his final meeting with Dolphins owner Wayne Huizenga, Saban told him that he would stay in Miami and honor the final 2 years of his contract, but at that point, Huizenga gave him his blessing to leave for Alabama.
It may have taken some time, but Mal Moore finally got his man. The Alabama athletic director and his new head football coach, Nick Saban, arrive in Tuscaloosa today to a hero's welcome, greeted by hundreds of enthusiastic Alabama fans.
You know, it had been nearly 15 years of really having a lot of things to deal with, two NCAA probations, coaching changes, scandal off the field, and I think that there was a real sense that, hey, here's somebody who can really come in and fix all this, and we don't have to just sort of sit here and tread water and hope that things turn out for the best. This is a guy that's going to start swimming in the right direction.
It really was a hard thing to put into words how energized people were, and when they finally saw him, you know, the whole plane incident, but when he spoke the next day and you know, seemingly without notes, and talking about how he was going to dominate his opponent and how he was going to do this, I mean, people were just, their jaws were dropping, and there was never a doubt after that things had changed.
I'm not going to talk about what we're going to accomplish. We're going to talk about how we're going to do it. Now, what kind of football team do we want to have here? You know, we want to be a big, physical, aggressive football team that is relentless in the competitive spirit that we go out and play with week in and week out. And what I would like for every football team to do that we play is to sit there and say, I hate playing against these guys. I hate playing them. Their effort, their toughness, their relentless resiliency to go out every play and focus and play the next play and compete in a game for 60 minutes in the game, I can't handle.
Well, what are your goals and aspirations for what you're looking for, you know, in a school and an opportunity, you know, sort of relative to college?
I would say more the education and more of the sports. And, you know, the history of the school and the longevity that I'm having with the school as far as, you know, alumni and whether it's 30 years later I can come back and, you know, it's still the same as when I first went there.
You know, we really try to create an atmosphere and environment here where we help our players be successful, first of all, as people. You know, secondly, as students. We want you to develop a career off the field. That's the thing that's going to have the most significant impact on the quality of your life, more than anything else when you go to college. We want you to be successful as a football player, have a great career, and see if you can develop a career as a football player. And then the last thing we want to do is use all the resources that we have as an institution to help you launch your career when you leave so you get the best opportunities in life.
He is relentless about recruiting. He puts an emphasis on recruiting, and not all head coaches do that. You know, and he's willing to take a call anytime. He's willing to make a call whenever he can. And also, he's willing to take the time to watch the tape and look at the tape and process the information and say, all right, this player's better than this player. And if we don't get the perfect one, we're going to get the next one or the next one, and it's never going to be a huge drop-off.
Coach does a great job. He looks at every single guy that we evaluate. Every coach, we cross-check every player that we do, and then we try to sell them on what we're doing here within the program. And it's not so much what we're doing on the football field, it's what we're doing off the field.
So we really do a lot in the personal development side of it to try to get the players to make good choices and decisions about what they do and what they don't do. You know, I always say you have freedom of choice, but you don't have freedom of consequence. So we don't want you to have negative consequences. We want you to, you know, do the right thing so you have positive consequences.
It starts with players. You know, you can have a great plan, you can have a great philosophy, you can have all outstanding coaches, but you still have to have players. And I think that Alabama has recruited extremely well. The player knows what he's doing. They stayed healthy. They play hard. And I think you go back in every place that Coach Saban has been, they've had that same kind of success.
He won at Toledo. He won at Michigan State. He won at LSU. He's winning here. He wins. He understands the part of football and why you win. It's the X's and O's, but it's the people and getting them to do it.
And I don't know how Nick or Bill Belichick or Coach Stallings or Coach Bryant would word it, but I think you have to have a philosophy that's sound in principles. And you have to be able to put that philosophy in place and integrate people into that system. And I don't just mean players, I mean support staff, coaching staff, equipment guy, that believe and are willing to contribute to that system so that you can allow yourself to have success.
After leaving Toledo after 1 year and going to the Cleveland Browns with Bill Belichick, I felt like maybe at times I made a mistake from a career standpoint leaving Toledo after 1 year, and I should have just stayed there and developed as a head coach. But I don't think that I would ever have reached the level had I not gone back, only because it was Bill.
The thing in Cleveland, you know, that we worked hard at was just the overall structure of the organization. Evaluating players, bringing them into the organization, developing them once they got in the organization, and then getting them ready to play and contribute on our team.
And those two things are the two things that impact winning the most. How you bring players to your team, how you develop the players that you have. And that's the two areas that I probably had the opportunity to learn the most in being around Bill for those 4 years.
And not just developing him as a player, X's and O's and techniques and lifting weights, but also his development and maturity in making a transition from college to pro or from high school to college. It's a different environment, there are different demands, the structure's different, and how to smooth out that transition so that the athlete can focus on his performance on the field and not get caught up in a lot of other things that are either distracting or counterproductive to, you know, where he's really trying to go. And you know, all of us need help with those kind of transitions.
How are you? Thank you. Well, what I wanted to do is welcome you all here today. You know, our goal for you is that you can be more successful in life for having been involved in the program. You're going to get an education that's going to affect the quality of your life forever. You know, we had Merton Hanks here the other day talk to our team, who's with the NFL Players Association, and he drew a line on the board, and it was 0 to 80 years old. And you know what? He couldn't name five players that played past 30. And then he had from 30 to 80. What do you do now? And if you have an education, you've developed a career off the field, and it gives you an opportunity to be successful and use the football notoriety that you got to enhance the development of that career.
You know, I don't think he really worries about national championships and SEC championships as much as people would think. He certainly doesn't obsess over it. He obsesses over trying to push people and make them better, make the players better off the field, on the field, make his staff better on a day-to-day basis, because I think he really believes that if he can do that, then Bama has a great chance to go compete for these different championships that are out there.
And it's the only way you can do it at a level this big at a university. The University of Alabama is a massive tradition, a massive history, a massive legacy, which could be very intimidating to a lot of people, and particularly if you don't have the right structure to deal with all of the various elements.
I talked to Nick about the way he does things, the way he did them at LSU, the way he does them in Alabama, and even some of the things he did at Miami. And I've changed some things that we do based on some of the thoughts that, and experiences that, and modifications that he's made.
I'd always sort of been one of these guys that was a rah-rah, emotional, inspirational kind of a guy to get the team ready to play. And there's probably one really memorable game that sort of almost changed the whole dynamics of the psychological approach that we use to motivate teams. And it happened when we played Ohio State in 1998. And they had been number one all the way through. We were 4-5, not a very good team. And we won that game. And we decided to use the approach that we were not going to focus on the outcome, that we were just going to focus on the process of what it took to play the best football you could play, which was to focus on that particular play like it had a history and a life of its own. Don't look at the scoreboard. Don't look at any other external factors. Just all your focus, all your concentration, all your effort, all your toughness, all your discipline to execute went into that particular play. And regardless of what happened on that play, success or failure, you would move on to the next play and have the same focus to do that on the next play. And that you would do that for 60 minutes in the game, and then you would be able to live with the results regardless of what those results were.
It's a great win. It's a tremendous job by everybody on this football team getting ready for the game, preparing well, staying focused, not getting caught up, and going out and executing, doing a tremendous job on offense. Defense played great for a long time, lost a little bit in the end. Special to everybody, did a great job, guys.
If you look at our record from that time on, since we sort of changed our approach, this is the end of the 98 season. 99 was a pretty good year. LSU, we had some pretty good years. And so I think that I've convinced myself through the years that the process-oriented approach is much, much better. And it's much better for competitors because it keeps them focusing on the right things, not the results, but what it takes to get the results.
Hey, guy. I can't tell you how proud I am of everybody on this football team. Just a little sad that some of the guys that have worked hard all year couldn't make the trip with us and be a part of this. You guys did a phenomenal job. I mean, a phenomenal job. And you dominated their you-know-what out there today. And I loved it. I loved every minute of it. And it's the first time I ever got dumped on with that water that I wanted to get dumped on. I wanted to get dumped on. You know, I'd like to thank the chancellor back here, Mark Emmerich. Yes, and I don't know if Skip's here. Did Skip make it or not? Skip's sick. Who has supported, you know, us in every way so that we can have the kind of program that we want to have. And I'm just proud as I can be of this group of guys. And we're going to get to play another game. And I talked about winning 12 games. And this is the first team in the history of LSU that ever won 12 games.
We had done some research on the number of players that came out of the state of Louisiana, and per capita, there were more players coming out of the state of Louisiana that were going on to play in the NFL than any other state in the country. Now people say, well, Florida, Texas, California, talking about per capita, there's not as many people that live in Louisiana. So for every 1,000 residents, the number of NFL players that come out of that is more than any place else. And I started looking at where those players were playing. They were going to Florida State, Miami, Texas, everywhere to play. And I started thinking, wow, if a coach goes there and keeps those players at home, that could be a great program.
They've got this many players in the NFL. There's got to be a good recruiting base there. which was always a little bit the issue at Michigan State. You know, you never ever went in where you were first. You know, you're in the shadow of Michigan, you're in the shadow of Notre Dame, you had to do a lot of national recruiting. So I felt like this was a wonderful opportunity to go to a place where maybe you could have a little better recruiting base, and if we could develop them the way I thought we could, that we might be able to have some special success there.
Here it is! Back home! SEC champion!
He was able to keep the players in, you know, rally the high school coaches, you know, get all the people associated with the university to buy into the football program, and then it just developed a culture.
I knew he was having an impact on the program at LSU at the time, and I would have people come up to me, literally administrators of the school, almost in tears in their eyes, saying, thank you for sending him to us. Thank you for bringing him to Baton Rouge. And I would just be like, wow, this guy's really having a huge impact here.
And I kind of got caught up in the trap a little bit there too, in that, you know, once you accomplish something like that, the expectation goes up and you feel like all of a sudden you can't satisfy everybody anymore. You know, and I learned a lot about myself going to the NFL in terms of who I was and what was important to me.
I think that's the challenge in which he's accepting now. I think that's the challenge of he's accepting right now, that, you know, of keeping Alabama on top. And I think he's got everything else. You know, I've been a coordinator and I've been a head coach in the NFL. I've won at different colleges. You know, this is the job I'll stay at. And I think Nick will stay there and retire there. It's my personal opinion.
What a pleasure to introduce the coach of the Crimson Tide, Nick Saban. Thank you.
You all are a great part of our team. A lot of people congratulate me on what our team was able to accomplish last year, but it's the team that did it. And it's our administration, Dr. Witt, all the things that Mal Moore has done in his administration here in creating an atmosphere that kind of sets the table for what we need to do to be successful, but also you, the supporters and the fans of our institution. It's what makes it special. The tradition is the spirit.
Get a job. When are you going to hire me? That's what we need to talk about.
You ain't never applied for a job. I know you can't.
I can't. Hey, baby, I go in there and sell water to a whale, baby. All you got to do is hire me, man. You know, I go in there just like you did on the Ryan side, baby. I go in there, hey, I'm Antonio Lane. But I was taught by Coach Saban, you should come down this basketball. I think Coach Saban can get it done.
You know, you have a lot of demands and a lot of demands on your time. And you have to understand all those things. I think that's why it's been a very difficult job for those coaches, whether it was Mike Dubose or Mike Shula, who were trying to learn on the job.
And if you talk to all the coaches that have been there, and they would really be honest with you and quietly on the side, they tell you that. They say it's a tough place to coach. It's a great place to coach. You can win big games there. You can win national championships there. But the expectations of the people are way out of whack.
And there's a certain aura at the University of Alabama that not a lot of schools have. Southern Cal's got it. Notre Dame's got it, although they haven't been very good with it lately. Texas has got it. And Alabama has that same reputation nationally.
I mean, you could march the governor and lieutenant governor and the head of the Supreme Court and all college presidents and the Alabama head coach, and that's who we would know.
When you were coach of the University of Alabama football team, that is, if you will, a uniform you don't ever get to take off.
Good to see you again.
Yeah.
He was talking about you guys.
Really?
It doesn't matter which man did.
Okay.
school you want us to pick.
What time does this thing start, Seth?
It started about 5:30.
Successful. Our players and coaches do a great job, but our fans are probably the key to it all.
There's a good shot. Good to see you again.
I'm looking at Tommy over there.
Got to go make a putt. See you, Bobby. Thanks for coming.
Even when I drove my route, you know what my goal was? I wanted to set a record every week on selling the most cases on that route. And I did it. We have another class that have been here for 2 years that have never lost a regular season game. So if they just think it's going to happen and they don't have to make it happen, and now it's their turn to be responsible for their own self-determination, they need to know what it takes and understand that it just doesn't happen. You got to make it happen.
12 seconds left to go in the third quarter from Bryant-Denny Stadium in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Trying to hold off Louisiana Monroe, tied at 14. Kinsman Lancaster, the quarterback, working from the gun. Blitz coming, catch is made. First down, touchdown, ULM.
Every coach that I've ever been around that sugarcoats it for the players, it does no good and it just blows up. The great tradition that we have here and the great institution that this is and the great state that this is and all the people that we represent, that's what you want? You answer that question.
The question was...
Don't stutter, answer the question.
And welcome in, everybody. That's the kind of day it was in Tuscaloosa today. Nick Saban's aftermath after losing to Louisiana Monroe.
You know, you go from one coach, one system to another, and you know, it's, you can buy into it as quickly as you want to, and you can want to do things the right way. It takes time to start doing things a different way, doing the things the way, you know, Saban wanted. And you know, kind of go through some growing pains there. Our first year,
it was tough. I didn't feel like all the kids bought in right away. They had some success, and I think that was a big challenge to get these guys to really buy into what we were selling, and not every kid did.
We had great talent on his team. We had some good players. We just couldn't never get it put together to where we could, you know, have a great season. And, you know, once Coach Saban came in and start implementing the way that he does things and the discipline with the team, it just seems like, you know, guys just started to see, like, okay, this is what we needed.
You could tell that Coach Saban knew what he wanted to do, that he was going to get things going in the right direction, and that he was going to change the roster in the way that he wanted it to be changed, bring in better players, bring in players that he was more familiar with from a character standpoint.
And what I think happened was a little bit of our failures that year helped provide those sophomores and freshmen and juniors that ended up being the catalyst to us winning it all. They realized that, you know, doing it the seniors' way that year wasn't necessarily the right way, and that if we bought in, we'd have a chance. And they really saw that the second year.
We recruit all the players that we recruit the same way, so that the ones that want to do what we want to do, they come to Alabama. The ones that really don't want to do it that way, they end up going someplace else. So it helps us
to get the right kind of guys that want to do the right stuff. And I think all those things contribute to you having a team full of champions. And if you have a team full of champions, which we did on our team last year, you're going to give yourself an opportunity to win a championship, which they did. And that all comes from your intangibles, who you are and how you go about what you do.
Ninth-ranked Clemson playing 24th-ranked Alabama. And the big question for the Tide was, would we see a difference with year two under Nick Saban, and would his top recruiting class help him tonight? The answer, yes and yes.
Tippin will kick. Low, it has distance, it is good! 54 yards. Left side, big blocking, Ingram walks it in. John Parker Wilson, the keeper, touchdown! Parker throws end zone wide open. Touchdown!
Be careful with Alabama. We all said when Nick Saban went to Tuscaloosa, it's not a matter of if, but when the Crimson Tide would be up there where LSU and all the big boys hang out in the SEC. Would it be in the third? Would it be in the fourth year? Right now, it looks like it might be year number two.
And we're down to the final 10 seconds. And that's going to do it. That is going to do it. Welcome to 2008. The world is again spinning on its axis correctly as Alabama has beaten the number 9 team in America decisively, 34-10 over the Clemson Tigers.
I think that game was a pivotal game because I think that game was the first game where our players sensed that if they buy in and do it the right way, which they had done, that they could accomplish significant things.
It was crazy that everybody just believed it. I mean, and that's what we did. We went in that first game, and as you know, I mean, the announcer said after the game, and the people said, you know, Alabama was just the more physically dominant team. And that's basically what we try to do week in and week out against every team that we played.
There was a statement that Alabama was going to play tough, physical football and had the players to do it. You know, that doesn't necessarily guarantee, oh, they're going to run the table and go undefeated in the regular season or exactly what the results are going to be, but I think from that point on, everybody knew Alabama was going to be a very difficult opponent.
Well, it's one game, you know. Confidence can screw you up. Confidence can be a good thing, but, you know, what our players need to understand, what our fans need to understand, what everybody needs to understand, it's one game. It's one game. And we need to keep playing better, and we need to improve, and our players need to have the focus to improve. And remember how they got where they got, rather than think that we can just show up now and beat whoever we play. Because we have a tendency to think that way around here. Instead of just kicking people's ass like you're supposed to and working to do it. All right, so when you ask me those kind of questions, it really pisses me off. I'm not pissed off at you. All right, but that mentality that you got to work and earn it, and then we got to earn it in the next game. And we're going to have to earn it in the next game. And what we did tonight was great. We won one game. We got 11 more. We need to take them one game at a time, and we need to improve as a team. And that's what our team needs to be focused on. And if we want to be a good team, that's what we need to do. That's how everybody should think. We made a B on the midterm, so we're going to take a week off and get a D and have a C average, or are we going to go try to get an A? This is one game. What we did in this game, it's one game. That's what it counts. I like for our players to have confidence, but I think our players played with confidence tonight. I didn't see anybody scared out there. I didn't see any fear. Now y'all scared to ask another question?
Here, they've got the extra tight end in dial on the right. Backs are in the eye. Give Coffee behind Johnson's block. He turns it upfield. Touchdown, Alabama!
Big news out of Knoxville today. Philip Fulmer will step down at season's end, capping off a 17-year run with Tennessee. This last one, a downer. 3-6, 1-5 in the SEC, a 20-point loss to Bama. So he's done after winning 150 games for the Vols, sixth best in SEC history. But in the end, the fan base not happy with this year's team, and the administration took action.
I think that he raised the bar. He helped people to understand just how competitive this conference was going to be. and that you couldn't do it without matching the work ethic that was going to be in place at Alabama. And so I think that some schools felt like they needed to make a change in order to keep up with that.
He forced one coach out, which is Tommy Tuberville. Tommy Tuberville had a great record, but you knew that Tommy Tuberville couldn't beat Nick Saban.
McElroy loads up, looks for Mays behind the defense. Touchdown. Over the shoulder. Touchdown, Alabama. A gorgeous play. McElroy running at full speed to chase down Marquise Mays in the corner of the end zone for McElroy. It is his first touchdown pass of his Alabama career. 34 yards, and it's a 35-0 Alabama lead.
Here's a school with a 6-game winning streak against Alabama. Not only was that game lost, the rivalry had already changed, and Auburn had been flipped from being on top to being on bottom.
Coach, after 6 straight losses to Auburn, to finally get that win against them, how important is it for this team?
Well, it's great for our fans. It's great for our players. We don't have one player on our team that ever beat Auburn. That was our goal. Guys did a great job of focusing on this game and not looking ahead. And they don't have a guy on their team that lost us. So, you know, this is something that we wanted for our seniors. We're glad, but we're also happy for all these fans that we have here. It's great for the University of Alabama.
Well, you mentioned it. Looking ahead, now you can focus on Florida, the SEC championship next week. They're playing their best football right now, one of the hottest teams in the country. You're probably being considered the underdog going in there. Is there a respect factor at all?
That's all right. I know it don't bother me any. I'm just happy we won this game. I'm happy for our players, and I'm happy for our fans.
Thanks, Coach. Thank you. Congratulations.
I don't know if our players thought we could beat Florida, you know, the first year we played them, even though we were ahead in the game, you know, 20-17, 9 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. We didn't finish. We had the opportunity and we didn't finish. And when you beat good teams, you have to be able to finish, because they're going to rise up because of the kind of competitors they are. They're where they are for a reason. Well, I think the biggest difference in our two teams were not talent or ability, but psychological disposition in terms of confidence, believing in something, and knowing that they could do it and they could finish it. This year's team had a I won't be denied kind of an attitude rather than can I do this or can I do that. So there was an expectation that if we did things a certain way, that we could beat anybody that we played. And I think that was the major difference in 2008 and 2009.
I had the honor of introducing not only the best football coach in America, but I think one of the best people in America, and his wife, Nick and Terry Saban.
You know, one of the signs they have in the football locker room is out of yourself and into the unity of the team. And this is such a wonderful team. The fact that you can be here and see where those dollars are going and how we can make a difference is a wonderful thing. What a great celebration. One of my favorite days out of the whole year.
Well, I love my mama. She's great. I mean, she's one of the nicest people in the world. She'd help anybody. She'd do anything for anybody. And she kind of follows in his footsteps where, you know, trying to teach the process and doing the right thing and being honest. Just been very good inspiration for me.
Well, I think any coaching family will tell you that it's difficult. It's certainly a challenge. It's a way of life. It's so much more than just a job. It is a way of life for the whole family. And I think the only way to be happy is to dive in and to be a part of it.
I think we go with the flow with his schedule. I don't think it ever really stops. He's usually constantly just doing something, even off season.
He works from 7 in the morning till 10, 30, 11 at night every day. So when he gets home, we always try to make a point just to be able to come say hey to him. If we just spend 5 minutes with him, it makes his whole day.
People kind of portray him as the real scary guy to talk to and be around, but he's actually just really relaxed and really fun to be around. And we'll go on the boat and he'll play his Eagles music and blast it as loud as he can so everyone else on the lake around us can hear. And he'll just get up in the aisle and kind of air guitar and sing to the words, and he knows every song by heart.
I'm his biggest supporter, you know. I'm out there, I cheer harder than any other fan in that stadium. I cry when we lose, you know. I'm just, the football season is great for us. You know, even though he's working hard and we don't get a chance to see him, we all enjoy the whole thing together.
You know, the way Nick's kids got started was because of my father. And I know you hear this story every year, but I'm going to tell it again in his memory, because this is really what this organization is in honor of, my father. We lived in West Virginia. We lived in a coal mining area. There were seven coal mining camps. He bought a school bus. He wanted to start Popcorner football. He went and picked up all the kids in the community, took them to practice, and then took them back home. And always said, if you ever get the opportunity, make sure you give back some kind of way. And what better way to give back than to help young people? And his motto was always, no man stands as tall as when he stoops to help a child.
The greatest, you got that Carnival Barker in you. I bet you could do the Ringling Brothers thing, little tuxedo on and the top hat and the whip. I mean, you do that very well. The greatest season ever. The way you can say that like you did in the commercial, Paul.
The greatest. Well, it was.
But y'all say that every year.
Well,
I mean, for the last 10 years.
Has there ever been a greater season than the most recent one for Alabama?
They're all.
I mean, undefeated. Heisman Trophy. I mean, it could have beat Auburn by a few more points. I mean, that would have made it better, but.
Oh, yeah, they could have. They could have not let Auburn push their ass around for 58 minutes.
We're trying to create an identity for this team, and that's what we have an opportunity to do. And everything you've done to this point, off-season program, summer conditioning, spring ball, fall camp, is for this. So every minute counts, guys. Every minute counts to go out there and dominate for 60 minutes. You start fast and you finish strong.
Here's the handoff, Richardson. They shoot the gap. Two men miss him. Richardson bounces free down the near sideline. 30, 20, 10, 5, touchdown!
It's passion, guys. It comes from down here. It's what you want. Go get what you want. Go fight for what you want. You have to earn it. You understand? They want to take what you got. You got to go get it and go after it. And every guy in here's got to do it for whatever your role is. Every play in the game for 60 minutes. You got it?
Yes, sir.
Tossing it, Ingram. Turns it upfield. He buries his head. He fights his way. He's in. Touchdown, Alabama.
Execute. Do your job. Everybody know, if I do my job, we're going to have success on this play. In everything that we do. And you got to go out there, guys, and change their mind about how they think. All right, you got to do it one play at a time, every play, slowly and methodically. We're going to play fast, and we're going to kick their ass.
Yeah! Looks left, throws left. Grabbed by Julio, breaks a tackle. First down for Alabama, 44 yards. The kick is blocked. Blocked by Alabama's Terrence Coney. The big guy comes up huge. Ingram, he rushes down the right side, 40. He's in the 45, 50. He's been running room down the right sideline. He's going to break a tackle. Upended. First down for Alabama. Crompton fakes the throw left. Here comes pressure. Down he goes. That was Marcell Dareus. The fans are cheering with that feeling in their stomach that's hard to explain. Daniel Lincoln from 45 yards out to win it for the Volunteers. The snap, the spot.
It's blocked by Alabama.
The Crimson Tide wins.
Two big blocks for the big man, Cody. Tell us what happened on that final block.
It was game time. I mean, if they would have made that field goal, game would have been over. Our season would have been over and stuff. And we just had to dig down deep. I mean, they played a real tough game today. And we just had to finish in the fourth quarter. We just had to finish.
You know, that was a very perilous game for Alabama. And to be able to find a way to win that game, to special teams, blocking field goals, I thought that was, once that happened, I thought, well, that's sort of the game that they had to get past.
Such a critical time in the season. We had a long run. It was a very physical season. We're a physical team. We practice physical. So for us to
keep everybody healthy. We're very fortunate to keep most of our guys healthy.
There's only so much you can do, you know what I mean? You can execute all you can, you know what I mean? And they still have the advantage because the kicker just take two or three steps and you get the ball off. And
so in the fourth quarter of the Tennessee game and the fourth quarter of the Auburn game, I'm yelling it, you gotta believe, to the people on the sideline. Because why not? Believe in it. Believe that we're going to block this field goal. Believe that we're going to drive down the field and get in the end zone. Why not believe it? Believe it. And the players would just be sitting there kind of jumping like, yeah, yeah. I mean, the best is watching the highlight of it and watching Coach jump in the air to do his, man, come on. Does it get any better than that?
Everybody's always told me that if you're going to win a championship game, that you've got to win the games when you're not playing your best. And that game in itself kind of symbolizes, you know, what we were able to do throughout the season in terms of just getting it done when we needed to and you know, pull out victories in all our games.
That and the Auburn game, I felt like a different person in the Auburn game because I kept saying to myself, I ain't gonna let us lose. And I had a big kickoff return with good field position, set the offense up with good field position. And we all was determined. Like, we kept saying it to each other. We're not gonna lose this game. We're not gonna lose it. So those two games, we had our backs on the ropes.
This is the story right here. McElroy under center. Busy backfield. Play action fake, rolling right, the throw to Upchurch. Touchdown! Touchdown, 4 yards! And Bama's on top, 26-20.
You know, I always talk about when you dominate somebody, you don't dominate somebody the first play. It's the 70th play of the game. So you have to sustain all these things. You know, the effort, the toughness, the discipline and execution, and do it with a relentless competitive attitude. And the guy can't match your intensity. He can't match your sense of urgency. He can't match it for 60 minutes in the game, and that's when you start wearing him down physically and emotionally. And I think that's the kind of team that we want to have. And I think when you have that kind of strength and character as a competitor, it gives you a tremendous competitive advantage.
Final play. Todd loads up, throws it for all he's worth, towards the end zone, battled in the air. Alabama wins 26-21. The Crimson Tide is undefeated and heading to the SEC Championship game.
What did the guys in Tangible say? I will not be denied. If you will not be denied in this game, you're going to give everything you got on every play. And if you got to put your hand up, put it up, and we'll get somebody else in there. But we do it, guys, by playing together, have faith, trust, and confidence in each other, and execute the plan. Do your job. Play your gap. Run your route. Follow the right guy. Get turnovers. Be physical on the line of scrimmage and do it every play in the game. Look, guys, there can be no glory without some pain. And you got your mind right to do it. And that's how I like it, and that's how we like it. So let's go dominate these guys for 60 minutes.
Last year, we lost to Florida, and then we turned around and lost to Utah. So I don't think people respect us as much because of those two losses. And that's something we're trying to change. We've been known to be a good team up to now, but we're trying to be known to be a great team, trying to be one of those top programs as well as Florida and Texas. We're just trying to be a dominant program.
Where we lost the game the year before, and it sat with me for 365 days, was in the red area. We got them to third down at least three or four times, and every third down inside the 10, they converted. They made a play. He scrambled. He hit a completion. He made plays. Tebow did. And we knew that we had to come up with a way to not allow him to scramble, to force him to throw the ball from the pocket and make him throw incomplete passes, and we thought we could cover their wideouts.
Tebow backpedals, look, throws. It is intercepted by Javier Arenas in the end zone.
We broke down a lot of film. Everyone took DVDs home to study and things like that, and we were so ready. You know, when you study film, you know, you anticipate things. And we felt like we knew what they were going to do before they did it. Like, the receivers, I knew when they were going to break off their routes. I knew their body language. You know, we knew them so well. because we wanted it so bad.
Once you watch the game and you see the intensity that was in our eyes and the things we were able to accomplish just by being more hungry, just by clawing for that extra inch, and we just kept it going throughout the whole game. We just kept making yardage and making first downs.
Given everything, given that it was a 1-versus-2 game, national championship implications, was the best game Alabama's played, probably, certainly since the 92 win over Miami.
The Alabama players played better and, in my opinion, harder than the Florida players in that game.
As McElroy gets the snap, rolls right outside the contain. He tries to tippy-toe up the sidelines, and he gets a first down! First and 10 from their own 49. Tebow has time, protection, and he's hit as he throws. He is hit from behind by Lorenzo Washington. McElroy under center, gives the handoff, Ingram up the middle. He's gonna fight, 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 fight. He's in! Touchdown! Single-season rushing record.
I think we did a good job of playing off the strengths of our team. We had a heck of a defense. So we put them into position where we didn't try to hurt them as much as maybe taking a lot of risks offensively.
The good players on the team played extremely well, and I think anytime you have a great year, that's got to be the case because everybody's not a great player, and the role players have to do what their sort of job is and be satisfied with that.
First and 10. There's the give, Richardson, near side, nice hole, big run, 20, 25, breaks a tackle, cuts right 34 to the 35, out to the 37-yard line. Julio in motion, they fake it to him. McElroy rolls right, looks back the other way, peek over the shoulder, touchdown! Touchdown, a magnificent throw catch! Ingram, the setback, gets the handoff, goes in for the third time today. Touchdown, Alabama!
Coach, Alabama has been waiting a long time for this, and especially this year, to defeat Florida, to win the SEC championship and a chance at a national title.
Hey, our players did a great job today, man. Our whole team, everybody in our organization, our fans, everybody that's a part of our team. And I'm so happy and pleased for our players. They learned a lot last year playing in this game. Florida's a great team, and our guys did a great job of being physical today, and I'm just proud of the fact that we won the SEC championship, and I'm going to just enjoy that for now.
You know, what Alabama did that night, I mean, they wrecked a dynasty. I mean, if Florida wins that game and wins a national championship, Tim Tebow, Urban Meyer, I mean, we're talking about so many incredible things, and just like it flipped with Auburn, it flipped that night with Alabama and Florida. Everything we're now saying about Alabama, Nick Saban's best coach in college football, Alabama's the best team. We were saying it about Florida, and we would have been saying it about Florida had they pulled that game out.
What you witnessed there may well be the same thing that Alabama's confronted with now. Florida been on top, successful, go for it, da-da-da-da-da-da. They're trying to stay there. Well, Alabama, it's your turn now.
Gets the snap, takes the knee. Alabama, the dreaming is over. California, here we come.
Their game plan is going to be to come out and go as fast as they can go. Coach Lynn, they think that puts the advantage to them, because they don't have to play physical then. Strike the guy in front of you, and it'll be second long the next play. They're going to run boot, they're going to run zone, they're going to run speed option. That's all they got.
Let's go hard in the hand. Let's go right leg. Pretty stretch. Move.
Let's go 9-8. Let's go 5-1.
Now lose our way. Press the ball. Got a hold of the hand.
Break there.
Now look, guys, you guys have paid plus points here to get here. You earned to get here. You earned it, man. You earned it. Now's the time to finish the climb. Climb the last summit. Today's the day to be your best as a football player. Every guy, in whatever your role is. Look, guys, it's one game. It's one game. You got a whole life to remember this game. So it's our time. It's our time. You make sure you play your best. It's our time, and we will not be denied.
Go on, three. 1, 2, 3.
Dominate!
You don't want to focus on the consequences of the game. And I tell the players, you know, I don't want you to talk about winning a national championship. I don't want you to talk about this is a national championship game. I don't want you to talk about this is the biggest game of the year. I want you to focus on what you have to do to play your best football, to dominate the guy you're going to play against for 60 minutes in a game, one play at a time, every play in the game. But assume that it's the best player you ever played against.
His biggest thing since he's been here has been attention to detail, on and off the field. If you pay attention to details, the exterior stuff won't matter. You know, all the people at the Rose Bowl, all of the media coverages and things like that. If you pay attention to the detail and just doing what you have to do, that stuff won't matter.
You know, you have to be on top of your business. You know, when you're going against one guy, 5 seconds of play, can you keep coming at him? Can you keep coming at him? By the end of the game, are they gonna say, I don't want any more of that. I don't wanna play them again. I won't play that guy again. And that was the mentality of the team.
Longhorns line of scrimmage. McCoy on the option look. He's gonna keep it. Oh, he gets hit and loses a yard as he goes up the middle. Marcel Darius is there along with Brandon Dederick watching the option look, and McCoy got nailed that time.
And McCoy is going off, dragging his right arm, Eli, there on that big hit on the option that they tried.
Our biggest fear was that McCoy would scramble and run a lot because he's a very good athlete, and we play a lot of match coverage where we don't have people looking at the quarterback. And it just so happened when he got hurt, that kind of took that weapon away from him.
Now on a 3rd and 5 from the 27. They're 1 of 6 in third down plays. Here's a throw. It is intercepted by Alabama's Javier Arenas at the 25-yard line. And Bama is back in business. Now a full house backfield. Here's the give. Ingram, touchdown, Alabama. He gallops behind Terrence Cody for 2 yards. 2nd and 9, Bama from the Longhorn 48-yard line. Richardson, the setback. Here's the give up the middle. Big hole. He may go. 30, 20, 10, 5. Touchdown. 48 yards. Trent Richardson up the pipe. Touchdown, Alabama.
You know, you have to take your hat off to, you know, our receivers because they didn't get frustrated because we weren't able to throw the ball. So now what they did, they had put on a different type of a hat. So now they became blockers down the field, which they did a fantastic job, which allowed our runners to make big plays.
I think this was a special group of kids we had last year that really gave of themselves. And that's one of the most important things in any team organization, are guys that put their egos aside for the betterment of the team.
2nd and 1, Texas from their own 37. Garrett Gilbert, the quarterback. Utah shovel pass in the middle, picked up by Darius. Marcel Darius. Darius to the 15. He spins to the 5. Touchdown! Touchdown! Marcel Darius.
Colt McCoy being knocked out. How did that affect your defense strategy and particularly your ability to be aggressive?
Well, you know, we had a different plan completely, but they would be a lot better team because he's a great player. So it's unfortunate for them. And we haven't stopped the run as well as we need on some of those speed sweeps and so forth, so we're going to have to make some adjustments to that. I'm sure they're going to open it up more, and we're going to have to play for 60 minutes in a game.
And Nick is very, very smart and is very alert on game day and does not get caught up into the all the excitement that can happen because you made a big play or they made a big play against you.
You've got to be calm, cool, and collected, and that's kind of how he is in the most critical moments of halftime and the critical moments between timeouts, between series. You got to make the players feel confident, and you got to have a toolbox with which to pull from when something isn't working. There's so many programs out there that are afraid to have the big toolbox because they get overwhelmed by it. But then they get put in a situation where they need something out of that toolbox, a different coverage, a different pressure, and they don't have it. And we've got a pretty good toolbox here, thanks to him.
1st and 10, Texas from the 17, their own. 3:08 to go in the ball game. Bama by 3. Gilbert, pressure. Anders hits him. The ball is loose. Courtney Upshaw falls on top of it. It is Alabama football at the 2. Again, Bama's got the beef in. Ingram is the tailback. In motion, Dial to the left side of the formation. The gift to Ingram, bouncing left side, fighting his way to the goal line. Touchdown! Touchdown, Alabama!
touchdown, Alabama. And that is going to do it. Alabama wins its 13th national championship. And the roses in this grand old stadium are once again crimson.
For the seniors, you know, going out with that win, that's huge, man. And for guys who don't even make it to the next level, that's still huge, man. Outside of football, it sets you up for the future. And, you know, playing for Coach Saban, it sets you up for the future.
When Coach Saban was first hired, you know, I was kind of struggling with my grades. And he knew what to do. He kind of paid a little more attention to me and got me in the right places. To be more successful. I ended up starting the next year and I ended up graduating after 4 years.
He really cares about the players. He really wants us to succeed as football players, but he always stresses us about academics more than he does about football. I mean, he wants us to be successful in life, regardless if it's playing football or if it's going on and to be a doctor or a lawyer, just whatever it is that we decide to do.
When his athletes come out of whether it was Michigan State or LSU or Alabama, they're very mature athletes. They're very mature. They know how to play. They know how to train. They know how to work. You know, they know how to budget their time. They know how to care for their bodies in terms of treatment and rest and nutrition and those kind of things. And he prepares them very well on that.
You know, it's human nature to be average. You know, survive. That's what we're sort of all geared up to do. So it really is special to win championship. It really is special to want to be the best. It really is special to have the perseverance to continue to want to do that even when you've accomplished something of significance.
He's very methodical in the way he approaches success, but he's always thinking ahead too. Even in, you know, one of the greatest moments of your career, he's thinking about, okay, now that we've won one, how do we win another one, or how do we win another one, or how do we continue this success? Because I think he'll probably buy into the fact that as hard as it is to climb the mountain, sometimes it's harder to stay there too.
It's not easy to maintain it. Other people got their eye on you. They want what you have, and it's like the heavyweight champ, you know? You gotta fight. You gotta go in there and fight. And if you don't, they don't call you champ anymore.
Probably 10, 15, 20 years from now, I'll probably sit back and say, wow, that was pretty cool. But because of the process, you know, that's what we were here to do. We were here to win games. We were here to bring a national championship to Alabama.
I mean, he came in the next morning. We were out there in California. He had it all laid out on his notepad, you know, everything that we needed to do from that point on once we got back on campus.
Right now, that's what our kids are focused on. They're focused on the next season, the first game at hand, and start the same way we approach it every year, that we've got to try to dominate our opponent. If we can out-physical them and dominate our opponent one by one, then we have a chance to win every game.
There's no easy way. And nobody ever told you it was going to be easy. I never told you that in recruiting. I never told you football was going to be easy. I never told you school was going to be easy. It's difficult. Most things worth having are. And there's some great lessons you can learn here for the rest of your life, because life is difficult too. But you're going to get out of it what you invest in it. That's what you're going to get out of it. That's what you're going to get out of school. That's what you're going to get out of football. That's what you're going to get out of your life. None of you guys are making any sacrifices here. You understand? You're investing your time in yourself individually to get better as players, and in your team so that you have something to accomplish that is significant. Last year's team invested a lot. And what did you get out of it? A lot.
We'll be right back.
Come on, Snoop. You can go, too. Come on. All right, Mama.
All right, Dada. Almost done, huh?
Yep. What's Nicholas? Are they going home today, or are they staying?
He said he didn't want to drive today, so they're staying here. All right.
Look how clean the water is, man. Check out my fish. You don't want to hear it like I like to listen to it. See, this is it right here. Can you do that?
I can play guitar.
Nicholas can really play, my son. I wish I could play. When I was a kid, you know, I grew up in an old Croatian Catholic home. I had to play accordion. I think that's why I started playing sports. So my dad said, if you play sports, you get out of practice accordion. I hated it. So I played everything.